All right, so next lightning talk up, we have Taejun and Joseph.
Hi, I'm TJ. This is Joey. We are software engineers on the productivity engineering team at Box. And to those of you who aren't familiar with what the productivity team does, we own all the tooling and services relating to continuous integration, development, and testing. So think of tools such as Git, Jenkins, test infrastructure, and a service called ClusterRunner, which is a tool that we built in-house at Box a few years ago and open sourced. And it's the topic of our talk today. So ClusterRunner is a distributed service that we built to achieve a single goal, and that's to execute tests in the fastest way possible. And it achieves this by horizontally distributing a workload across whatever competing resources that you allocate ClusterRunner. And ClusterRunner efficiently utilizes these resources by using historical timing data from previous builds in order to best distribute the workload. You interact with ClusterRunner through a RESTful API that we provide, and this lets you integrate ClusterRunner with any automation or CI that you might already have. Now, I could talk all day about all the features of ClusterRunner and why it's so great, but showing is better than telling. And so we've dedicated the second half of our talk into showcasing ClusterRunner in action. So I'll be deferring the list of all the features until then. Now, this being the test automation conference, I don't need to sell you on the importance of writing and running automated tests. We're all here because we care deeply about shipping quality software in a timely manner, and we want to explore the various aspects of achieving that. So the aspect we're focusing on today with ClusterRunner is test volume, specifically running the most amount of tests in the shortest amount of time possible. Now, test volume, when you first start running unit tests, is not really an issue, because there's few enough of them, and they run very quickly, and your developers have no issue running them locally on their dev machines. And eventually, you will probably adopt a CI system, such as Jenkins, to run them remotely and asynchronously on a more powerful machine than your MacBook, probably. But as time goes on and your code base grows, your test code base should also grow, because your developers should be writing unit tests, hopefully. And that leads to the development and test iteration loop getting longer and longer, which in turn turns into engineers losing productivity, waiting for their automated test suites to complete. And we saw this happen firsthand at Box. So we introduced developer-written integration and unit tests in 2012 to our primary code base, which is written in PHP, so we use PHP in it. So a couple weeks in, our entire test suite took about 10 minutes to run on a single machine serially. And a couple months later, we're up to 45 minutes for a single build. A year later, we're up to 3 hours. And today, we're up to 30 hours to run our PHP and test suite once on a single machine serially. So this is what success looks like. You want a lot of code coverage. You want to instill a culture of quality and testing in your engineers. And getting to this point is very difficult, and it merits a talk on its own. But today's talk is about, it's not about evangelizing good testing practices. It's about what do you do once you reach this point? Because you obviously can't expect your developers to wait 30 hours for a build to complete. That's absurd. And this is not a build that we want to run once per release. It's a build that we want to run every single time a developer pushes a code review, merges a trunk, has some sort of experimental changes that they have in some remote branch. So at Box, that roughly translates into several hundred builds every day. So the target here is to run this 30-hour test suite several hundred times every single day. So what do you do? Well, it seems like a problem that you can throw money at in the form of test hardware to paralyze the test execution. So test servers are relatively inexpensive compared to the salaries of engineers, especially in Silicon Valley. So it's an obvious investment to make, and it's one that most companies do make. So let's say you got the purchase order approved. Let's say you ordered and delivered the servers. Your data center guys have networked and racked these servers. Now, all you need is the actual software to paralyze the execution of the tests to utilize this new hardware capacity. So before we determine what tool to adopt to do that, we first had to analyze what our requirements were. So at Box, we got several teams, got dozens of Git repos written in several different languages, and they have their own corresponding unit testing frameworks. And additionally, we have functional tests, performance tests, linters, and all that good stuff. And as I mentioned in some of the previous slides, some of these test suites take a very long time to complete. So based on these facts of life at Box, we devised a set of requirements for the tool that we want to adopt to parallelize our tests. So first requirement is that it has to be easy to configure and use. The engineering teams at Box own their own CI system and the configurations of their tests. So if the tool requires like an entire DevOps team to configure and use, they will simply not adopt it. Second requirement is because we have so many different code bases and test technologies and frameworks used, it has to be test technology agnostic, because we don't want to use a tool that works just for one team. It's got to work for everyone. And last but not least, it has to give us fast test feedback. And the whole reason why we're investigating this is to get fast test feedback, so that's an obvious requirement. So at this point, we did what any responsible engineering team would do. We looked online for existing solutions, ideally something open source, but we were willing to pay for an enterprise license if we found something that we liked. And at the time when we searched, we didn't find anything that met all of our requirements, which was very surprising to us because it felt like it should have been a solved problem by now. And so we decided then to solve the problem once and for all, and we invested a couple quarters into building ClusterRunner, and we made it publicly available in 2014 by open sourcing it. So we've been using ClusterRunner since 2014, and it's an absolutely irreplaceable service in our CI stack now. The 30-hour test suite I was mentioning earlier runs today in 17 minutes. 17 minutes. So to get you an idea of the order of magnitude of the difference, 30 hours is more time than I spend writing code on a very good week. 17 minutes is how long I spend replying to an email. So the only reason why it takes 17 minutes to complete is because our longest test file in our PHP test suite takes about 16 or 17 minutes to run. So if someone were to break up that test file into smaller test files, ClusterRunner would give you feedback in as fast as the next slowest test in the test suite. All right, that's enough context. I'm going to hand it over to Joey to show you guys ClusterRunner in action.
Thanks, TJ. All right. Go. Okay. So I'll go through the four main steps that you would follow to set up ClusterRunner up for your project. So the first one being bringing up the cluster, so getting the ClusterRunner service running on your infrastructure. The next part, setting up your project, so basically just adding a config file to your repo. And then after you have your cluster set up and set up your project, obviously you want to execute your build and look at the results. So first, bringing up your cluster. ClusterRunner, it's all contained within a single executable. So we have the master service and the slave service, all part of the ClusterRunner executable. So this is pretty straightforward. There's no extra dependencies. You just run ClusterRunner master, you give it a port, and then you run ClusterRunner slave on all the slave hosts that you want to attach to the master and basically just point it at the master. All right, and this can be done manually. This can be done by some config management tool. This is just how you would do it manually. Cool. So that's it for setting it up. That's once it's up and running, you can hit an endpoint on ClusterRunner's API. So ClusterRunner communicates via REST APIs. This one is the slave endpoint. So just taking a look at what that would look like. So this has two connected slaves to it, and this just gives you a whole bunch of info on each slave. So basically, its current status, so if it's working on a build or not, and then some kind of state information, like how many executors it has, and that type of thing. Cool. So that's it for setting up the cluster. It's pretty straightforward. So setting up the project. So as I mentioned, you will just add a single ClusterRunner YAML file at the root of your project repo. This is a small file. I'll show you an example here in a second. It tells ClusterRunner which commands you want to run your tests, and also how to distribute them across the infrastructure. So yeah, here's a very simple example of ClusterRunner YAML. So you can define multiple jobs in a single ClusterRunner YAML file. This just has one job named PHP unit. And the first section commands tells ClusterRunner how to run your test. So in this example, we're just running PHP unit on each test file. The second section describes how to distribute your test across the infrastructure. So a single unit of work in ClusterRunner is called an atom. And this atomizer's command tells ClusterRunner how to generate those atoms. In this case, every atom corresponds to a single test file. So we're just running a find command, giving it star test.php. This will just return us a list of all the test files, and those will be plugged into that command section up above. We made this very simple intentionally. This was like one of our main requirements when designing ClusterRunner. As TJ mentioned, we're a central team at Box. So we own the cluster and the infrastructure that it runs on. All the individual teams own these files in their projects. So the individual teams own their tests. They decide what goes into the ClusterRunner YAML file. So this makes it really easy to separate ownership. Cool. So this is like an example of the individual commands that would be generated after we combine those two sections together. So we're just running PHP unit on each test file in the repo. All right, and then so each of these commands basically gets distributed across the infrastructure. So now we're ready to execute a build. So this is another subcommand of ClusterRunner, ClusterRunner build. This works like an API client of the ClusterRunner master. Basically, all it does is send an API request to the master. You could easily just do that API request manually. So this is pretty straightforward. You just give it where the master host is. You say it's a Git type project. Give it the URL to your Git repo, and say which job name within your ClusterRunner YAML that you want to run. All right, and that's it for running the build. So if we could play the first video. This is a visualization that we built to kind of visualize how a build runs. So the big circle represents a build. The small dots represent the slave hosts. So you'll see that one popped off right away. So that means all the work is in progress. That slave couldn't pull any more work for this build. And then obviously there's a few tests that take a lot longer than those first tests. So these second hosts will take a lot longer. And it's done. OK, we can switch back to the slides. Cool. So the build ran. Great. Now we actually need to look at the results to get anything out of it. So here's another endpoint on ClusterRunner, the build endpoint, just the build ID. So you look at this. It'll give you a ton of information about what happened during the build. So just kind of starting from the top, you can see the status is that it's finished. There were no failures. It gives you a human-readable details message. 5 of 5 subjobs are complete. An error message if there was any, number of atoms, et cetera. The term subjobs, basically, ClusterRunner batches, this is kind of an aside, ClusterRunner batches atoms into subjobs to send them to the slave hosts. It just does that to reduce network overhead and sending tons of atoms to the slaves. So that's what subjobs means. Another nice thing about this is this will list all the failures right here, if there were any. Luckily, in this case, there were not. Cool. You can drill down even further with the API, so you can look at each individual subjob that ran. Looking at this, it's kind of small. Hopefully, you can read it. Basically, it will list every atom that ran, which command it ran, and the amount of time it took, the amount of expected time it took. So as TJ mentioned, ClusterRunner is keeping track of how long each test takes to run and using that information in future runs. Cool. And you can also get the exit code from here. So ClusterRunner uses the exit code to determine failure or success. The last way that you can get build results is you can actually download an archive file of containing all of the build results. So this is pretty similar to the last two API responses I showed. If you download this file and expand it, you get kind of a breakdown of each subjob or atom that ran, and then you get the command, the console output for that that test run. So this would be like the console output from running PHP unit, exit code, and amount of time. ClusterRunner also lets you, in your ClusterRunner YAML, put files into an artifact directory. So if you did that to save artifacts from the build, they would be in this archive file as well. OK, so here's kind of the different picture of the same build that I showed, the same animation I showed. You can see that one slave host finished very quickly. There were two other ones that went on for a little longer. And maybe one of the first things you notice is that this is not the best way to run these. This is not the best order to run these in to take advantage of your whole infrastructure. So ClusterRunner will, it'll look like this the first time you run a build. The next time you run it, it will optimize. So it'll use that timing data from the previous run. It'll run the longest test first, and generally you get way better timing for future runs. Cool. So here's a quick video that we took a while ago. This is our production ClusterRunner instance at Box. So it's sped up, but you can kind of get an idea of how dynamic this is. And you can see slave hosts switching from one build to another. They don't have to wait for all the slave hosts for a single build to finish before they can work on another build. So that's that. We can switch back to the slides. We don't have to wait. Thank you. Cool. Cool. So that's pretty much it for setting up ClusterRunner and running your build. This is kind of our wish list, what's next, what we want to do next. AWS integration with autoscaling. So right now, ClusterRunner has endpoints for adding slaves and removing slaves pretty easily. It'd be cool if we could do that dynamically and scale up the fleet as we needed it. Also Docker support, so running tests in containers just to avoid environment differences, improvements to the deployment mechanism, in-place upgrades so that you don't have to take the whole cluster down to update it, and then a web UI. So the visualizations I showed are kind of just individual dashboards right now, so it'd be cool if we could integrate those and actually have a full web UI. So yeah, we love it when people get involved. We love feedback. If you want to check out more, go to clusterrunner.com, and that also has a link to our GitHub repo. And if you have any questions, email us at productivity@box, and we will be happy to help you. And that's it. Oops.
Very good. Thank you, Taejun and Joseph. Although I think if you had built that cute visualizer first, people wouldn't have minded waiting 30 hours just watching that.
That's probably true.
It's very saved a lot of time.
People always just stare at the TV near our area.
Yeah. Who wouldn't want to watch that for 30 hours? We have time for one question because of the lightning talk, but how do you distribute the binary to the testing nodes?
Do you want to take this one?
So yeah, this is a part of our deployment mechanism. So ClusterRunner ships with a pretty simple command line tool, and a part of it is ClusterRunner deploy, and you specify a list of slave hosts. So the master takes its own copy of this binary and deploys it to those slaves. So there's a prerequisite requirement right now where the masters and the slaves have to have SSH keys exchanged beforehand, otherwise the deployment will fail. So the short answer is the binary ships with both the master and the slave in the same binary, so you can run it in different modes.
That's part of the deployment thing that we want to improve.
Yeah, that's something we're not happy with. That we'd like to deploy it as an RPM and put it in Yum and stuff, but it's on our wish list.
Yep. All right, very good. Thank you.